With the most recent rap game murder being Takeoff, one third of the extremely famous rap group Migos, I noticed my reaction was very bare, very minimum. It wasn't because I wasn't a fan of the music, but it's just a story that seems so common, seems so once or twice a year you hear about a rapper getting killed. And I wanted to figure out not so much why, but how long has this been happening? And I started scrolling through the different statistics, and I started to just look up from the 80s when the rap game started, how many rappers have been getting killed? Who's been killed? And I started scrolling through a bunch of different names, going through the long list. And I found a familiar name. It wasn't Tupac Shakur. It wasn't Christopher Wallace, aka Biggie Smalls. It wasn't Nipsey Hussle, but it was Lamont Coleman. I remembered that name. And then I realized, oh, aka Big L. Now I get it. Times have changed drastically since the 1990s of hip hop, also known as the golden era. A lot of people don't listen to the old stuff anymore. A lot of kids don't even realize what the old stuff is. But even in 2022, if you want to have a conversation about the greatest rapper of all time, the best flow, best lyrics, best style, best freestyle ability, Big L is required to be in your conversation. To the majority of casuals, he's unheard of, but just like MF Doom, he has been dubbed your favorite rapper's favorite rapper. Being somewhat of an underdog who didn't reach mainstream success, it makes it understandable as to why he isn't a household name when the greatest rapper conversation comes up in the blunt rotation. Also, being murdered at the ripe age of 24 doesn't help much, especially after only being able to release one album before his untimely fate was met. But who was Big L? Why hasn't he talked about enough? Where did he come from? Is he the reason Jay-Z got his big break in the rap game? What led to his brutal murder? Let's find out. The youngest of three brothers, Lamont Coleman was born in 1974 and grew up in the Uptown neighborhood in Harlem, 139 and Lenox Avenue, also known as the Danger Zone, which he mentions in numerous songs. This is the same neighborhood fellow rapper Cam'ron grew up in. It was an extremely rough area, notorious for violent crimes and drug using and selling. But Big L leaned towards music, freestyling and battling other cats in the neighborhood starting at the age of 12. I've been researching and listening to Big L since I was about 15, and one thing that I always stood by was how he embodied the definition of what a real, raw rapper was. Not just because he had bars, but because it seemed like that was the one thing he wanted to perfect and be the greatest at. Faith Newman, who was a former A&R at Columbia Records, stated, "What I knew about him was that he was totally focused on his art. There was no ego there. He was probably one of the most humble people I've met, and probably one of the most introverted. I don't think he would have worked in the internet era. He was a pure MC, he was real, not like fucking game playing industry people. He'd be sitting there thinking of what clever hooks am I gonna use." Now, I've clearly never met the dude, but just through interviews and research, he really seemed like a cool cat who wanted to rap and make music that was just what he was passionate about. In his last interview before his death, he stated, "In the beginning, all I ever saw me doing was battling and battling everyone on the street corners. Rhyming in the hallways, beating on the wall, rhyming to my friends. Every now and then a house party, grab the mic, a block party, grab the mic." Comparing that attitude to modern day rappers, you could tell L was a real MC who looked at it as an art form and not just something to hop on because everyone else was doing it. And we need to recognize that this time period and specific region in the United States was the hotbed of some of, if not the greatest rap music ever created. New York had the entire 1990s on lock when it came to gritty lyricism, impeccable rhyme schemes, and the legendary and extremely influential boombap instrumentals from producers like Havoc, DJ Premier, Pete Rock, Diamond D, RZA, and Lord Finesse. In the 90s, Big L's potential to get on the map would take a turn for the better when he crossed paths with Lord Finesse, who was attending an autograph signing at a record shop. You always see those videos or hear stories of people on the street spitting lyrics in front of established rappers, trying to persuade them that they're the next big thing and promise that they'll do anything to get signed. 99% of the time that shit doesn't work. Just another inspiring MC's soul being crushed, accompanying millions of other aspiring rappers' dreams in the deserted void of a wasteland filled with "check out my mixtapes and I'm gonna be famous one day" type of statements. I was that guy one time in my confused youth. But the difference between me and the rest of these aspiring artists is, well, Big L was nice with it. In a 2009 interview, Lord Finesse stated, "One day I was at an autograph signing for Funky Technician, and here comes Big L. He's telling me how nice he is, and I brushed him off. I just gave my manager's number, and he said, 'Look, man, I want to rhyme right now for you. And if you don't like me, you'll never have to hear from me again.' I thought that was a fair deal. Make a long story short, after he finished rhyming for me, I was getting his number." Lord Finesse, who was already an established and well-respected producer, who also could supply bars of his own, became L's mentor. 1992 was the year that shit started to fall into place for Big L. Finesse would take him with him to interviews, get him stage time, and produce for him. I believe the first appearance Big L made was on Yo MTV Raps. I don't even think he said anything, he was just sitting in the corner while they were interviewing Lord Finesse. This was right before L would take off into the underground.
Biggie's the illest kid in the world, man. What's up,
Big L?
What up, Big L? Have a seat, man. Yo, we gonna go.
The Digging in the Crates crew, or DITC, formed by Finesse, Diamond D, and Showbiz, would feature Big L on a B-side track titled Party Over Here, 1992. This would be his first professional appearance. He would end up becoming a part of DITC, accompanied by a few others such as OC, Fat Joe, Buck Wild, and AG. Joining DITC led to a signing to Columbia Records in 1992. He ended up getting dropped from the label a year later due to his rapping style, due to his lyrics, and overall, I guess, swagger not being marketable. Kurt Woodley, former Columbia A&R, stated, "The people at Columbia didn't understand that you have to get the street beat first and then move on to the mainstream. When L started coming with all these underground urban grassroots rap records, they didn't get it. There was like, oh, we can't get on the radio with this right away. We can't take this top 30. So I think a lot of people started to fade their attention from L, which I didn't understand. That was not their world at the time." Makes sense, because the things he was talking about, and the, I guess, just style and the lyricism, it was gritty as fuck and definitely wasn't radio material for the most part. His lyrics definitely had shock value. "Every Sunday a nun lay where my gun sprays." Brutal. Now, there's a few different originators of horrorcore rap in different regions in the 1990s. My examples would be Brother Lynch Hung coming out of Sacramento with that West Coast gangster rap, cannibalistic, baby killing, eating brain shit. If you want to go down south to Memphis, you have Lord Infamous doing the original triplet flow, possessing satanic energy while talking about shooting people and pushing them down a flight of stairs. And then you have Big L, also known as the Devil's Son. His gritty lyrics really painted a picture of the Harlem streets in the 90s. "They make my white ass feel like a gangster for 3 minutes until the song turns off." T.E. Jules Farrar, one of L's close family friends, remembered, quote, "He was always a fan of horror movies and he was into real morbid shit. Like somebody grandma would be walking and they'd be going across the ice and they fall. Like, why would you laugh at something like that? If he knows who that person's grandson is, he would bring that up later and snap on them." Contradictory to his lyrics, L really did seem like a cool dude who just used metaphors to paint a vivid picture of what Harlem looked like at that time. One of his close friends stated, "Big L wasn't really a street guy. He was really around that element and very well respected. I think it was his brother that was extremely respected as far as it goes by the streets. He never really had problems like that." Big L had two older brothers and one was extremely feared in the area. This gave Big L a pass on a lot of situations, but ended up being a main factor in his demise, which I will explain later. His lyrics are one of a kind, in my opinion, the punchline king. His debut album, Lifestyles of the Poor and Dangerous, is a perfect example of these punchlines and gritty lyrics. My personal favorite on the album is,
"I jumped out the Lincoln, left him stinking, put his brains in the street, now you can see what he was just thinking."
Oh my goodness, that is fucking, it's dark and brutal, but it's amazing. Released in 1995, the record saw decent success. Music critics praised those lyrics, but didn't seem to be fond of the production. MF DiBella of AllMusic complimented Big L as a master of the lyrical stick-up, undressing his competition with kinetic metaphors and a brass comedic repertoire, while noting, "With better production and marketing, Big L might have found himself with a platinum album, but instead he settled for platinum respect." Sometimes platinum respect could be better than platinum success, I guess. Lifestyles of the Poor and Dangerous is one of those albums that is time-stamped in history as one of the greatest rap records you might not have heard of. It was overlooked due to fellow East Coast rappers such as Nas, who blew up worldwide. Many songs on his album were legendary in the underground hip-hop scene of the 90s horrorcore style. Lord Finesse, the main producer of the album, stated, "Columbia Records wanted something with a hook that would be kind of catchy and something they could get radio play with. Like, everything L did was dark and it was gangsta and it was what was the popular style at the time, the horrorcore shit. So they needed something bright, something friendly, and Put It On just matched everything perfect." Put It On was one of three singles from the album, and you can tell its sound was different and much less intense, but in my opinion, the best song on the album. Extremely catchy and shows that horrorcore wasn't the only route L had to take to be making music. A month before the album dropped, one of the best freestyles ever recorded took place. February of 95, on the Stretch and Bobita radio show, Big L and the, at the time, unknown Sean Carter, aka Jay-Z, entered the building equipped with Super Hot Fire. Everyone knows who Jay-Z is. Go ask your grandma and she'll say, "I've heard of him." At the time of this freestyle, nobody had a clue who the dude was. Big L was making a name for himself before Jay-Z had a single fan. It's a crazy thing to think about because so many people are clueless as to who L is, while Jay-Z is the richest rapper in hip-hop history and has a kid with Beyonce. The best part of the freestyle was, it wasn't planned in a sense that it was supposed to be just Big L, but both him and Jay-Z ended up back and forth, almost like a battle. The vibe was competitive, but lo and behold, Jay and Big L actually had battled in Harlem prior to the freestyle. This freestyle is set in stone as one of the best ever. And just to point out, Jay-Z is most likely in my top 7 of all time, but who knows what his career would have turned out to be if he was not invited by Big L on this freestyle. You never know. I haven't used any examples of lyrics or punchlines that Big L has stated, but a good example would be his 98 freestyle, which is also on the Stretch and Bobito show. Everyone's favorite is the 95 freestyle with Jay-Z, but this 98 version is my personal favorite, with legendary one-liners that he was known for. What'd he say?
I'm far from broke, got enough bread, and mad hoes, ask Beavis, I get nothing but head.
It's little things like that, that are hilarious, well thought of, and they just flow good. Punchline King. Big L's lyrics could either be sinister or resemble a stand-up comedian's material. He was so ahead of his time, his parents haven't met yet. His sophomore album featured legendary producers such as Pete Rock, DJ Premier, Lord Finesse, and others with songs like Ebonix and The Heist, which later would become staples for L's discography. Ebonix was released as a single in 98 through his own independent label that he formed called Flamboyant Entertainment. The Source called it one of the top 5 independent singles of the year. Dame Dash, CEO of Rockefeller Records and business partner with Jay-Z, knew Big L for some time. In February of 99, he planned to sign Big L to the record label. He stated, "Just like with Cameron or anyone else, L and I was friends first and foremost because of our history together. I knew Big L through childhood. Big L was there at the battle between Jay-Z and DMX. Big L went with me with the camera. He was the one taping it. We came up in that era when crack was out, so we were seeing each other at the rooftop and at basketball games that Rucker used to have on 139 for a while. He was from a really solid block and I was from a good block as well. We were survivors on that level, so we always considered each other brothers. At any given time, if there was anything I had that could benefit him, I was there for him." However, 1 week before the deal was to be finalized, Big L was shot 9 times in the face and chest, killed instantly on the same street he grew up on. He was 3 months shy of his 25th birthday. Although the murder of Big L is unsolved, there's rumors that have been seen to be believed as true with people that have firsthand knowledge of the parties involved. The story goes, a man by the name of Gerard Woodley, a friend of Big L and his family for many years, had some ongoing beef with Big L's big brother Lee, the one that I mentioned earlier, who was feared in the streets. Woodley was looking to kill Lee, but Lee was incarcerated at the time, so Woodley chose to murder the next closest thing he could, which would be Big L. He was arrested 3 months after the murder, but would end up being released due to lack of evidence. 17 years later, Woodley would then be gunned down himself in the same exact area where Big L was killed in 99. Apparently, this Woodley fellow was deep in the streets with several bodies on him, which ended up coming to bite him, specifically in the back of the head, something that police sources say he was always worried about. Woodley's cousin wrote a book and it consists of extremely in-depth details in regards to Big L's murder. I'm not going to regurgitate too much of it because I don't want to just spit a bunch of bullshit that I don't know anything about, but if you do Google, there's actually a lot more information regarding Big L's murder that I actually just found out. Growing up, I always thought it was just some unsolved thing, but if you just do a quick Google search, check it out. Finesse vividly remembers the day that he got the notification that L passed. And a side note, kind of creepy fact, but I just realized that this is his album, his killer, supposed killer is in the background in this album, because there's a bunch of his homies in the background and he's in this, the supposed Gerard Woodley fella. Just thought I'd point that out. Lord Finesse vividly remembers the day that he got the notification that Big L passed away. I just remember coming in the house and my beeper was going bananas. I get the phone call and they told me where he was at. 139 between 5th and Lennox in them buildings. I just remember him laying there and they had sheets over him. It was me, Showbiz, and Joe. We all met down there. We stood there. We couldn't believe that this was happening. This was actually L, all on the floor covered. I was just hurt. I was beyond hurt. I was done. Tears couldn't stop coming out of my eyes. Dude had so much going. The phone kept ringing. I didn't want to talk to nobody. I couldn't believe that this happened. The youngest member out of all of us. How did you go before all of us? To this day, it just never adds up. It is one of hip-hop's biggest mysteries, or what-ifs. What if Big L would have never died? What would have happened to the rap game if he did sign to Rockefeller Records? His second album was released a year after his death and is now certified platinum. His punchlines, flow, and attitude go unmatched, and he has a clear influence on a lot of the rappers that came up after him. In my opinion, he's a top 10 of all time and deserves all the respect of the MC world. Senseless violence has taken the lives of way too many great talents that have inhabited the rap game, a game that doesn't seem to always be worth playing. I hope that was a good enough script that I wrote down regarding Big L. You gotta dive deep to get a lot of information just because he was so underground. And I don't know. He does cross my mind once in a while. I think about Big L. It was a very mysterious kind of thing to think about. That's why he's known as one of hip-hop's biggest what-ifs. What if? What could have been? He only really released one album while he was alive. And he seemed to have one of the greatest natural talents of rapping, dropping bars, lyricism, you name it. He just is an overall real raw rapper. And I don't know. I feel bad. I feel bad that he never got a chance to show what he could really done. And I always think about that deal he could have signed with Jay-Z. That would be insane. Who knows what would have happened. But all I can say is rest in peace to Big L, Lamont Coleman. I hope I did this video justice.